Bob Fosse was not one to rest on his laurels. In 1973, he earned Best Director honors for three different productions. He won a Tony for Pippin, an Emmy for his TV special Liza with a Z, and an Oscar for Cabaret, edging out Francis Ford Coppola for The Godfather. But before he even received these nominations, Fosse was hard at work on his next two projects: Chicago, a musical tailored for his estranged wife, Gwen Verdon, and Lenny, a biographical feature film about the notorious stand-up comedian Lenny Bruce. Fosse and his longtime editor, Alan Heim, contextualized Lenny Bruce's stand-up routines with multiple cutaways to pseudo-documentary-style interviews. I'd like to start with a scene showing Lenny and his wife, Honey. We begin with a two-shot close-in on Dustin Hoffman and Valerie Perrine, respectively. Please pay particular attention to the rhythmic properties of the edits, both the cutaways into and out of the scene, and the reaction crosscuts within the scene itself. It's also at this point that I'd like to mention that Lenny Bruce talks about women's bodies in particularly crass terms in this scene. So if you'd like to skip it, I'll put a timestamp down below.
I like that.
So I thought maybe we could work something out that we could do together.
What, a double act?
Yeah.
Dig what I mean. Like, you talk to the average guy. Hey, look at that chick over there. I mean, isn't that a pretty chick?
Oh, yeah. She's beautiful. Oh, she's got a real pretty face and nutty drugs.
Would you marry a woman like that?
Oh, yeah. Are you kidding me?
Would you let your wife dress that way?
No, are you kidding? Knock her right on her ass.
Well, what'd you dig her for in the first place?
Well, you know, her jugs were sticking out.
But you don't want her to dress that way now.
No, you're crazy. That's my wife.
Well.
The scene opens on a close-up of Lenny in the car. He's objecting to his wife's occupation as a stripper, and the scene is cross-cut with footage of his wife performing. We return to the two-shot in the car before quickly being pulled into the nightclub, joining one of Lenny's stand-up routines in the middle. We transition into the routine with two quick cuts. The first, a close-up on the audience member laughing at an unheard joke, and the second, a medium shot of Lenny from behind. Next, we hear the setup for the joke. This shot, a close-up on Lenny, is the longest in the sequence, while the punchline and the audience reaction pass by fairly quickly. Next, the joke unfolds in a single close-up shot of Lenny. And the reactions to this joke are cut into a short, short, long pattern. The extra beat given to the third reaction, the woman clearly not laughing, underscores the off-color humor for which Lenny Bruce was famous. As in the previous joke, the setup for the final joke in this sequence is framed in a single close-up. The punchline finds a profile of Lenny in a medium shot, punctuating the joke by raising his left arm and guiding our eye back to the left of the frame, where we return to the opening two-shot of Lenny and Honey in the car before we can even process the punchline. In this admittedly detailed discussion, I find inspiration for tracing the interaction of various types of rhythm, both musical, physical, and visual. Isolating these aspects of rhythm informs our analysis of not only this sequence in Lenny, but all of Fosse's films. Although this scene does not include music per se, the editor, Alan Heim, uses a rhythmic approach to his cuts, especially the audience's reaction shots. In fact, Bruce's speaking rhythm inspired Heim's editorial decisions. Quote, "It's a pictorial and verbal rhythm. At a certain point, it becomes exactly that, a rhythm moving on, hopefully picking up the tempo and getting to the end." End quote. Later, during an interview with Heim, I asked him about the tempo of Dustin Hoffman's delivery, who was playing the character of Lenny Bruce. Heim replied that, quote, "Lenny was the most complexly structured script I'd ever read," end quote, and that he suggested the idea of intercutting the stage performances with scenes from Lenny's life. Heim continued, quote, "This enabled us to spend less time on Dustin and thus speed up the pace of his performance." In the remainder of this talk, I will examine Bob Fosse's filmography for exactly these types of situations, where the rhythmic load is carried not solely by the dance, or the music, or the visual cuts, but the intersection of these three parameters. As a dancer, choreographer, pseudo-editor, and director, Bob Fosse was uniquely attuned to the role of rhythm in many contexts. His professional experience was wide. His early career as a vaudeville dancer led him to Hollywood, where he signed with MGM in 1953 and even choreographed a short number in Kiss Me, Kate. But he didn't direct his first feature film until 1969's Sweet Charity, starring Shirley MacLaine with cameos by Cheetah Rivera and Sammy Davis Jr. As mentioned above, Fosse directed Liza Minnelli twice in 1972, in the feature film Cabaret and the TV special Liza with a Z. This latter occasion brought Alan Haim into Fosse's life. A frequent collaborator and film editor, Haim teamed up with Fosse again three more times. Lenny in 1974, Fosse's first non-musical production, All That Jazz in 1979, his not-so-thinly-veiled autobiographical film, and Star 80 in 1983, his tabloid exploitation film. As we examine portions of these films, please keep in mind that over the life of each project, Bob Fosse wore many different hats, if you may pardon the pun, as a choreographer, director, and pseudo-editor. In my next example, I turn to Cabaret and its opening number, Willkommen. This sequence uses the same style of cross-cutting that we saw earlier in Lenny. Throughout the film, Fosse juxtaposes images of Berlin grappling with the rise of the Third Reich, with performances inside the Kit Kat Club. Also like Lenny, reaction shots inside the club comment on and frame the performances on stage. For example, inside the club, reaction shots linger on the audience, which is composed of nearly still-life shots. While on the outside of the club, quick jump cuts reveal the vitality of strangers in the train station as Brian Roberts arrives in Berlin. These stark juxtapositions of the audience and the performers, along with the others outside in Berlin, provides a rich vein to mine for humor.
Meine Damen und Herren, Mesdames et Messieurs, Ladies und Gentlemen, comment ça va? Do you feel good? Ich bin euer Konferencier. I am your host und sage willkommen, bienvenue. Willkommen im Cabaret, au Cabaret, zu Cabaret. Leave your troubles outside. So, life is disappointing. Begin. In here, life is beautiful.
3 years prior, Fosse used a similar technique in his first directed feature film, Sweet Charity. The title role, performed by Shirley MacLaine, is certainly a comic one, and humor is the defining characteristic of Charity's song, If My Friends Could See Me Now. After a chance encounter results in a date with the Italian movie star Vittorio Vitale, Charity hams it up in his luxurious Manhattan apartment. A series of soft or arrhythmic cuts transition us directly into the song.
If they could see me now, that little gang of mine. I'm eating fancy chow and drinking fancy wine. I'd like those stumble bums to see for a fact the kind of top drawer, first rate chums I attract. All I can say is, wow, look at where I am. Tonight I landed, pow, right in a pot of jam. What a setup, holy cow. They'd never believe it if my friends could see me now.
A high angle long shot features Charity surrounded by the opulence of Vitali's apartment. The medium shot tightens the focus on Charity herself, and a close-up completes the introduction. At the end of the first verse, Fosse uses a series of hard cuts to create an almost parenthetical effect. In the first sequence, a series of jump cuts refrains Charity in various places throughout the apartment over the dialogue, "They'd never believe it."
They'd never believe it. 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 They'd never believe it.
In the second sequence, Charity explores the possibility of Vitali's top hat, practically a religious icon for Bob Fosse. A series of 8 shots frame Charity in different poses and actions. Ultimately, these examples illustrate that humor can be a product of rhythmic manipulations. In the next examples, however, humor is replaced by a more functional rhythm, wherein the musical, physical, and visual rhythms are joined together to instill a different emotion for the viewer. The rhythm of life, which occurs near the end of Sweet Charity, uses a series of hard cuts, or cuts on the downbeat, to build a large-scale rhythmic foundation. This sequence is an early high-water mark for Bob Fosse, as it telescopes inward on itself, drawing both Charity and the viewer deeper into the scene. Carried by Sammy Davis Jr. as a charismatic guru and Ben Vereen as a featured dancer, each frame of The Rhythm of Life is staged with intricate and dynamic formations of Bob Fosse's large ensemble. The editing of this song is the antithesis of the quick cuts we saw previously. Now, we begin with long cuts in the opening section before giving way to shorter cuts in the bridge of the song. Here's the first verse and chorus. And I want you to look for the rhythmic augmentation of these cuts. There'll be 4 double 8 counts that give way to 3 quadruple 8 counts, the first of which I label cut 5, sees the dancers in a sort of zombie walk as they come down the ramp.
Spread the religion of the rhythm of life, and the rhythm of life is a powerful beat. Puts a tingle in your fingers and a tingle in your feet. Rhythm in your bedroom, rhythm in the street. Yes, the rhythm of life is a powerful beat.
To feel the rhythm of life, to feel the powerful beat. To feel the tingle in your fingers, to feel the tingle in your feet.
There is go, 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 beat. To feel the tingle in your fingers, to feel the tingle in your feet.
Daddy spread the gospel in Milwaukee, took his walkie-talkie to Rocky Ridge.
Blew his way to Canton, then to Scranton, till he landed under the Manhattan Bridge.
Daddy was a new sensation, got himself a congregation, built up quite an operation down below.
With a pied piper blowing while the muscatel was flowing, all the cats were go-go-going
down below.
Daddy was a new sensation, got himself a congregation, with a pied piper and operation down below.
This last shot is thus far the longest single shot in the sequence. It is the first one in which the camera actually moves. The tracking shot moves over the car and then pans left, following Sammy Davis Jr. as he slides out from underneath the car. This phrase marks a turning point in the song, too. It brings us to the bridge, which features not only more active camera work, but also much shorter phrases, both lyrically and visually. This sequence is the song's bridge, and the rhythmic diminution in the cuts is immediately evident. Every cut now occupies just 8 beats, not the 16, 32, or 64 beat phrases from before.
Flip your wings and fly to daddy. Flip your wings and fly to daddy. Flip your wings and fly to daddy. Fly, fly, fly to daddy. Take a dive and swim to daddy. Take a dive and swim to daddy. Take a dive and swim to daddy.
Swim, swim, swim to daddy.
Hit the floor and crawl to daddy.
Hit the floor and crawl to daddy. Hit the floor and crawl to daddy.
Crawl, crawl, crawl to daddy.
Flip your wings.
Fly.
Flip your wings.
Fly.
Flip your wings.
your wings. Fly. Flip.
Indeed, the last three phrases, which are marked by an asterisk in the chart, begin on the pickup or the eighth beat of each prior phrase and are emphasized by a glissando in the percussion. The rhythmic erosion continues as the eight-beat phrases further subdivide into two-beat phrases at the very end of the sequence. After the quick-cutting eight-beat phrases of the bridge, Fosse then moves to the large ensemble dancing in an extended single take, occupying more than 64 beats, which we didn't really see in this sequence. Here in The Rhythm of Life, we can see Fosse guiding our understanding of the scene. The opening verses and chorus train us to expect long, balanced phrases and visual cuts. The longer the cut, the slower the rhythms on stage, too. The bridge reverses those expectations as Fosse places Sammy Davis Jr.'s character in the center of the frame, quickly cutting back and forth every eight beats. And then the dance break returns to the beginning rhythms with a single take, allowing the camera and the viewer to enjoy the full ensemble. My final example today is from the film All That Jazz. It studiously avoids the balanced cutting found in the previous number, The Rhythm of Life. The most vivid example of this can be seen in the number Take Off With Us. Featuring a smaller ensemble than Sweet Charity, the song Take Off With Us is set within the relatively cramped performance space of the Broadway Arts Building. Its claustrophobic framing and frantic pace of editing produces both artistic and dramatic effects. The film's editor, Alan Heim, described the cutting of this sequence to me in an email correspondence. The complex interweaving of the sexual relationships caused us to add a little music here and there to finish the beats, so the cutting patterns were established by the choreography. The use of soft cuts, so to speak, imbues the performance with energy, but also foreshadows the stress of our protagonist, the Bob Fosse stand-in, Joe Gideon, as he presents material to his producers for the first time. Notice the hemiola-like dissonance between the strong downbeats in the percussion and the groups of three beats in the early edits. The frantic nature of the cuts in the introduction to this song is enhanced by the physical setting in the rehearsal space and the tight close-up of the camera angles. By shooting this sequence almost entirely with close-ups, Fosse invokes a claustrophobic setting that mimics the high-pressure scenario of Joe Gideon showing this number to his producers. In fact, Alan Heim is on record as saying that Fosse used 25 different setups in this sequence, and we can see eight of those here in the first minute. This overview of Bob Fosse's filmography uncovers a unique perspective on how his films work. As the choreographer and director, Fosse was intimately involved in the rhythm of his films, and in the editing booth he attained an even higher level of control. Pauline Kael, in her 1974 review of Lenny, noted that, quote, no other director had entered movie making so late in life had earned such technical proficiency. Fosse is a true prodigy. This proficiency speaks to Fosse's overwhelming sense of rhythm. As a dancer, choreographer, editor, and director, his primary impulse was rhythmic. Indeed, even the slightest disruption was cause for concern. After seeing a rough cut of Cabaret, Fosse was visibly shaken. The editor, David Bretherton, had deliberately displaced shots of the dancers onto the musical offbeats, hoping to emphasize the seediness of the Kit Kat Club. Fosse told Bretherton to recut the film, but not before unleashing this insight. Quote, the most important thing to me as a choreographer is for that toe to hit that floor at that particular second. This strikes me as a most appropriate summation of Fosse, both as a choreographer and as a man. My findings see Fosse deliberately using cutting rhythms to underline the scene at hand. In his early work, especially Sweet Charity, the most traditional musical in his output, Fosse tends towards more conservative hard cuts on the downbeat of large musical groups. After that, Fosse began to exploit more flexible approaches to rhythm. I also find that Fosse juxtaposes rhythmic cuts, both hard and soft, to underscore artistic, humorous, or dramatic elements of the film. Fosse's unique standing as a director, choreographer, and de facto film editor makes his relatively circumscribed film body of work an intriguing test case for thinking about the rhythms of film editing. To quote Sammy Davis Jr., yes, the rhythm of life is a powerful beat. Thank you for watching.